morning.
Good morning.
Good morning. I got to look at you. It's been a while since I've been in here. I think it's been like 3 weeks, so I got to look at your beautiful faces. Welcome. Welcome. You could have been anywhere doing anything this morning, and you chose to be here. Next time, grab some other people. Let them know they also can choose to be here on this amazing Sunday morning when we get to worship together and commune with God. The Creator of the universe is with us today, and I'm so excited to be here and share that with you. I'm Reverend Ann Kovan. I'm your associate pastor here at Central. Our mission at Central is to follow Jesus. And we do that by loving God and loving our neighbors. When you came in, I hope that you picked up an order of worship that guides you through the service and has additional information. And our Under the Dome, this is the February edition. It's got a calendar of events, and it's got news and messages from pretty much every area of ministry in this church. So we want everybody to have one of these. So please pick one off the greeters' tables before you leave if you do not already have one of these. If you are a first-time guest with us today, welcome. I'm so glad that you chose to be here today. And we have a gift for you. About halfway through the service will be an opportunity during Connect and Refresh to visit that back table and fill out a Connect card, and we'd love to give you a gift that just lets you know that God anticipated you being here and that you are loved. And if you came in and you forgot to sign in at the table or put your offering in the offering basket, you can, all of y'all can do that at that same time in the service. I'm going to highlight a few things that are going on in the life of the church. Today is Scout Sunday. It's being celebrated with the Scouts in the sanctuary, but that doesn't mean that we can't celebrate it in here today. And I'm a big fan of Scout Ministries and mission. So that is our prayer focus of the week, to keep that ministry and mission in our prayers for the good that it does. And I'm just curious, are there any Scouts in here, whether older Eagle Scouts or current Scouts that may be in here, if you would stand? All right. Way to go. Tomorrow is Monday, and then the next day is Tuesday, and then the day after that is Ash Wednesday. We have two services on Wednesday, one at noon in the sanctuary and one at 6:30, and we are still having our Wednesday night dinner, so you can come and you can eat, and then you can migrate from here over to the sanctuary. If you're not able to make it at noon, you can come at 6:30. And then the following Wednesday, not this Wednesday, but the next Wednesday, we start our midweek Lenten services at noon. If you can get away on your lunch break and come and hear a message from 12 to 12:30, and then we have lunch together. Lunch is $8. You don't need to register for that. Just come and you can pay at the door. But it's the Lenten midweek service is just a good way to anchor yourself in Lent for the duration. This weekend we have our parking lot ministry. We'll be doing food prep here in the kitchen at 3 p.m. If you want to help, you want to drop in and lend a hand, you're welcome to do that. And then we show up at the parking lot on Saturday morning around between 7 and 7:30 if you want to serve. And it's a back parking lot of Hope Health on Palmetto Street, just a few blocks from here. Also, on Thursday, we have a children's outing to Skate World at 5 p.m. this Thursday. If you go to the website under upcoming events, scroll down, you can hit the link and register for that. If you have a child and are looking for something to do on Thursday night, that's going to be a lot of fun. Yeah. You gonna go? All right. Let's take some deep breaths and make that transition from the busyness of getting here to being here as we have just a few moments of silent meditation.
Good morning. It's my turn to get to welcome everybody. And as Ann said, yeah, it's been like 3 weeks since we've been in here. And, you know, me, as far as I don't look at this as just a job, my heart needs this. And I've been able to, been blessed for the last 2 weeks to be able to help with the smaller children and then youth last week. But I said, What a joy it is when we do come back that we have everybody here on the first Sunday, that all of us are back in here to worship. So if you would, let's stand as we sing our creed this morning.
I believe in God our Father. I believe in Christ the Son. I believe in the Holy Spirit. Our God is three in one. I believe in a life eternal. I believe in the virgin birth. I believe in the saints' communion. And in your holy church, I believe in the resurrection. When Jesus comes again, I believe in a life ever after. In Jesus' name, amen.
You know, Ann just talked about the parking lot ministry, and that's kind of us as Christians, that's kind of what God wants us to do. You know, it took me a while, but once you get out of that comfort zone and start sharing his word with people that you normally wouldn't communicate with, you normally wouldn't have a day-to-day conversation with, it just adds extra blessing to your life.
It's crowded in worship today. As she slips in, trying to fade into the faces, the girl's teaching laughter is carrying farther than they know, farther than they know. But if we are the body, why aren't his arms reaching? Why aren't his hands healing? Why aren't his words teaching? And if we are the body, why aren't his feet going? Why is his love not showing them there is a way? There is a way. Traveler is far away from home. He sheds his coat and quietly sinks into the back row. The weight of their judgmental glances tells him that his chances are better out on the road. But if we are the body, why aren't his arms reaching? Why aren't his hands healing? Why aren't his words teaching? And if we are the body, why aren't his feet going? Why is his love not showing them there is a way? Jesus paid much too high a price for us to pick and choose who should come. We are the body of Christ. But if we are the body, why aren't his arms reaching? Why aren't his hands healing? Why aren't his words teaching? And if we are the body, why aren't his feet going? Why is his love not showing? Dim, there is a way. Jesus is a way. I was sure by now, God, you would have reached down and wiped our tears away, stepped in and saved the day. But once again, I'll say amen, and it's still raining. And as the thunder rolls, I barely hear you whisper through the rain, I'm with you. And as your mercy falls, I'll raise my hands and praise the God who gives and takes away. And I'll praise you in this storm, and I will lift my hands. For you are who you are, no matter where I am. And every tear I've cried, you hold in your hand. You never left my side. And though my heart is torn, I will praise you in this storm. I remember when I stumbled in the wind. You heard my cry to you and raised me up again. But my strength is almost gone, and how can I carry on if I can't find you? And as the thunder rolls, I barely hear you whisper through the rain, I'm with you. And as your mercy falls, I'll raise my hands and praise the God who gives and takes away. And I'll praise you in this storm, and I will lift my hands. For you are who you are, no matter where I am. And every tear I've cried, you hold in your hand. You never left my side. And though my heart is torn, I will praise you in this storm. I lift my eyes up to the hills. Where does my help come from? My help comes from the Lord, the maker of heaven and earth. I look my eyes up to the hills. Where does my help come from? My help comes from the Lord, the maker of heaven and earth. I lift my eyes up to the hills. Where does my help come from? My help comes from the Lord, the maker of heaven and earth. And I'll praise you in this storm, and I will lift my hands, for you are who you are, no matter where I am. And every tear I've cried, you hold in your hand, you never left my side. And though my heart is torn, I will praise you in this storm. And though my heart is torn, I will praise you in this storm.
You may be seated. Tell you, I am blessed and thankful to have such a wonderful group of musicians and singers up here with me that I get to do this with. I really appreciate all of you up here. But you know, we were talking a while ago about the parking lot ministry and about how we get the chance to communicate with people that we normally wouldn't in that case. And you know, a lot of those people don't know who God is or who Jesus is and what he can do for their life. And that's kind of what this next song talks about, is exactly what God can do.
Without him I could do nothing. Without him I truly fail. Without him I would be drifting like a ship without a sail. Jesus, oh Jesus, do you know him today? You can't turn him away. Oh Jesus, oh Jesus, without him, how lost I would be. Without him I would be dying. Without him I'd be enslaved. Without him life would be hopeless. But with Jesus, thank God, Jesus,
us pray. Jesus, oh Jesus, thank you for finding us, giving us a place of belonging. Thank you for bringing us together in this place. We've all had a week. Some have suffered more than others, and some have had greater joys than others. And some here came running this morning. Some came crawling. Some came dragged. Some are here wondering why they're here and debating if you're even relevant in their life when they pass through these doors later this morning. To all of us, grant us your peace. Grant us your wisdom and an openness to seek you and to desire your wisdom, ears to hear your calling, to know our place in the world and our purpose. And Lord, in this world that surrounds us, there's so much chaos and violence, senseless death, things that we just cannot understand. Remind us again that the goodness that you have woven into the fabric of this world has been torn by our sin, and that we live with the consequences of our sin and others, but living such with your love and your spirit that we can overcome all things. And so we lift up to you, God, our neighbors, those who are hurting in their bodies, those who are hurting in their minds, those who are hurting in their relationships, that you would make them whole, that you would heal us, that when we leave here today, we will be more like you than when we got here this morning. And be with us as we worship, as we praise you through song, as we hear your word through prayers and message. Help us to be truly one, one with you, one with one another, and one with all the world, especially as we pray the prayer that Jesus taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. And give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever. Amen. Any children going to children's church can follow Miss Lauren out. This is our time of worship that we call Connect and Refresh. It's still worship because you greet one another with the love of Christ. Hope you will greet your friends, those you know and those you don't know yet. And you can refill your cup. You can revisit the greeters' tables. You can get more to eat. And we will let you know when it is time to go on with the next stage of worship. So please connect and refresh.
making your way back to your seats. I just want to say I am grateful to have Christy here this morning playing the piano. It's always a blessing. She's very talented and makes all of us sound better. So thank you, Christy. The song I am going to sing, I think most of you know at least the ending of this song, which is one of my favorite hymns. So I love this variation.
Grander earth has quaked before, moved by the sound of his voice. Seas that are shaken and stirred can be calmed and broken for my regard. Through it all, through it all, my eyes are on you. Through it all, it is well. Through it all, my eyes are on you. It is well with me. Be it from me to not believe, even when my eyes can't see. And this mountain that's in front of me will be thrown into the midst of the sea. Through it all, my eyes are on you. Through it all, it is well. Through it all, my eyes are on you. It is well. It is well. So let go. And when still know his name, so let go my soul and trust in him. The waves and wind still know his name. So let go my soul and trust in him. The waves and wind still know his name. Waves and wind still know his name. It is well, my soul. My eyes are on you. Through it all,
came to the other side of the sea, to the country of Gerasenes. And when he had stepped out of the boat, immediately a man out of the tombs with an unclean spirit met him. He lived among the tombs, and no one could restrain him anymore, even with a chain, for he had often been restrained with shackles and chains. But the chains he wrenched apart, and the shackles he broke in pieces, and no one had the strength to subdue him. Night and day, among the tombs and on the mountains, he was always howling and bruising himself with stones. When he saw Jesus from a distance, he ran and bowed down before him, and he shouted at the top of his voice, "What have you to do with me, Jesus, Son of the Most High God? I admire you by God. Do not torment me. For he had said to him, "Come out of the man, you unclean spirit." And then Jesus asked him, "What is your name?" And he replied, "My name is Legion, for we are many." He begged him earnestly not to send them out of the country. Now there on the hillside, a great herd of swine was feeding, and the unclean spirits begged him, "Send us into the swine, let us enter them." So he gave them permission, and the unclean spirits came out and entered the swine and the herd, numbering about 2,000. They rushed down to the steep bank into the sea and were drowned in the sea. The swine herds ran off and told it in the city and in the country. Then people came to see what it was that had happened. And they came to Jesus and saw the demoniac sitting there, clothed and in his right mind, the very man who had had the legion, and they were afraid. Those who had seen what had happened to the demoniac and to the swine reported it. And then they began to beg Jesus to leave their neighborhood. As he was getting into the boat, the man who had been possessed by demons begged him that he might be with him. But Jesus refused and said to him, "Go home to your friends and tell them how much the Lord has done for you and what mercy he has shown you." And he went away and began to proclaim in the Decapolis how much Jesus had done for him, and everyone was amazed.
Amen. This is the word of the Lord. All right. So my dad was putting it lightly to say he was a history buff, but we were always getting dragged to battlefields and museums and historic homes. And I recall being little and bored, especially on some of the tours, some of the old houses that we went into. We would go visit Monticello. We would go visit places where Ben Franklin had lived and worked, and Thomas Edison's house. And anyway, in all these places, where the rooms where the most interesting things were roped off. You know how they let you kind of go in and see a bed? You can walk into a room, and there's like, oh, well, that's where they slept, and there's their dresser and a little water bowl. And then they would take you to the kitchen where all the interesting things were, and they'd have a rope. Like, no, you can look from here, but you can't go in and touch all those fascinating cooking utensils. We do this with our spiritual life, where we rope off compartments or spheres of our life that we don't take Jesus into. And we guard those areas, and Jesus comes in, and he wants to remove those ropes. He wants to unravel all of the ropes that divide us from himself, that divide us from other people, and then those areas where we literally are dividing up our lives and putting things into compartments that won't touch each other. I was at a conference, a Bishop School of Ministry, this week. It's a conference where United Methodist clergy from all over South Carolina come together, and we get to learn, and we have a good speaker, and we were having a little breakout session, and we have heard, you know, over and over and over again, we hear the message, the church is dying, all of the mainline Protestant churches are on the decline, young people aren't interested, they're spiritual, but they don't believe in the church, and they don't trust institutions, and everything's just terrible. And they were asking us to talk about how are we enabling our congregations to be more invitational, and one of my colleagues shared, he said, well, for example, I had a woman in my church who's very active in her bridge club. And he was making the suggestion, well, maybe you could invite your bridge club ladies to come to church. He said, but she said, that's my wine group. Wine's okay with Jesus too. You know, you don't have to keep those two things separate. But Jesus was always unraveling, crossing lines and unraveling ropes. We rope things off, and every time he crossed that Sea of Galilee to the other side, he was undoing these sort of compartmentalizing ropes. And this story today, it shows how Jesus is unraveling the way we compartmentalize our political lives, our economic lives, our cultural lives, and our personal lives. And he does this when he gets to where the Gerasenes reside in this place called the Decapolis. First, we see how he is entering into a political situation and is dealing with a political situation. This area called the Decapolis, you see, when Rome would come in and defeat a territory, they would seize all of anything that was worth anything. Houses, livestock, land, businesses, they would seize, and the people who had owned it would be thrown out, and they would reward their soldiers, and they would give these houses and these farms and these businesses to Roman soldiers who would then sort of be like bully sheriffs, kind of keeping the peace by terrorizing all of the people who were there before. So this was a place that was very, very Roman. And yet there is Jesus going among them. And it's interesting that swine are mentioned here because it was really common for the Jews living in this occupied place to refer to the Roman soldiers as pigs. And they would say they acted like swine. There's also a clue here that the name of the spirit that is tormenting this man is named Legion, because we know that that's a military, Roman military unit. Jesus is trying to tell us that he is not for political structures that benefit a few at the expense of many. He would rather heal one man than go along the status quo of the political situation at that time. He broke economic lines. Whoops. He broke economic lines as well. You see, these people here, they were just going about their lives, the status quo, right? They were running their businesses. We know there's a huge swine herd here. So that has to be a major part of the local economy. And yet Jesus heals the man at the expense of the town's economy. And there's a clue here that this man is healed. He's He's returned to normal, and the people don't celebrate that he's been healed. What do? It says they're afraid. Jesus has just ruined their cash crop. And so they run him off in the same way that he runs the swine off into the water. The man has been healed, but at the expense of the local economy. Jesus was confronting an evil system. It valued profits and jobs more than the well-being of individuals. Religious lines, dividing lines that Jesus is crossing. You see, Jews wouldn't have gone to this place if they could help it. They saw the people living there as unclean. They didn't live their lives the right way. They didn't behave right. They didn't worship God the right way. And according to all of the Old Testament codes, none of the people who lived in this area would have been allowed to worship in the temple that was Jesus's and Jesus's people's religious home. You know, eating or being around pigs was like hitting rock bottom for Jewish people. But Jesus was calling the religious people, the churchiest of all the church folk who were the really super religious Jewish people, he was calling them to a new way of loving others that would call them into places that they would rather not take their God into. Jesus just unravels that rope. Culturally, Jews were different than the forces and the people of the Roman Empire who were occupying that territory. Jews were actually a minority. They looked very different from Romans. They had dark skin. They had dark hair. They were religiously strange. The Roman people thought that the Jews were very strange, and they kind of barely let them go along with their religious life. And the people especially who lived in this area of this territory of Decapolis. So Jesus comes into this place where he's a minority, born on the wrong side of the tracks, holding very little power. If a Roman soldier wanted to throw Jesus in the ditch, he could throw Jesus in the ditch, and Jesus couldn't have done anything about it. Jesus crosses to the other side to heal a man who would have never wanted to do good for Jesus, most likely. Jesus came for the hated and the hurt, but he also came for the hated of the hated. Those who were living in this occupied area were not Jewish, and yet Jesus was there healing and spreading the word of God. The good news is that Jesus is not prejudiced. He unravels ropes of exclusion for each and every one of us, which brings us to our last category or sphere of life that we like to rope off, and that's personal. That this is very, very personal, because we often find ourselves on the wrong side of the rope. That we have all found ourselves pushed aside, out of sight, out of mind. We have all tormented ourselves with regrets for bad choices. We have all lived with some kind of shame for things we've done or not done. We have all carried guilt for things that we have done or thought. There have all been times where we feel like we don't belong, or that maybe we deserve to be pushed aside. we are the one that so desperately needs Jesus' healing, that Jesus would cross over every dividing line to get to us, to give us the same healing. This story is about Jesus, God's only Son, putting everything on the line to restore us to wholeness, to bring us back into belonging, to wipe away everything that is holding us back, to level out all of the thorns and the divisions that we erect between us and others because we don't want to be hurt again. This is a story about Jesus trying to patch the holes of self-betrayal that we have punctured into our own souls, drilled by self-criticism and self-blame and thinking that we're not good enough. He's come to ease the pain and to unravel the knots of depression and anxiety and other mental illnesses and physical illnesses, emotional illnesses. This is why Jesus has come. So at that conference, our speaker, Dr. Doug Poe, who actually wrote the book that we had a sermon series on back in the summer called Transforming Evangelism, Faith Sharing the Wesleyan Way. And he talked about change and how we don't like change. And he compared change to transformation, that Jesus doesn't seek to change us, he seeks to transform us. And he talked about transformation in terms of the caterpillar and what kind of creature the caterpillar is when it enters into that chrysalis. And all of the metamorphosis that happens is changing the very structure of a created thing. Everything about that caterpillar is transformed. And when it leaves that cocoon, it's an entirely different creature. He said the difference between transformation and change, well, the example of change would be like water, liquid water, cooling to the point where it can change into an entirely different state. It can be frozen into a solid. But a change is reversible. Water, frozen water, can go back to being a liquid or it can go back to being a gas. But a transformed creature cannot go back. You cannot be the person that you were before Christ has transformed you. And this is a daily thing. Jesus cares about every aspect of our lives. Jesus cares about how we vote. He does. He wants to be there with us. Jesus cares about how we run our businesses, how we work, how we treat people when we leave these rooms of this church. He cares that we are going into places that we would rather not go to bring healing. And all of this happens with a choice. It's a choice to follow Jesus and to give Jesus access to every part of our life. Because he's already come and he is already there and he is already knocking at the door. And it begins so easily with a prayer and an answer and a response. So let us pray. God of the Jew, God of the Gentile, God, our Father of the Son, Jesus, who you sent to make us one. who you sent to make us whole, who you sent to wipe away, to obliterate every line that separates us, that separates us from you, that separates us from one another, that separates us for the fullness of life that you intend for us if we would allow you to be the Lord of every part of our lives. That you only see one life, that you do not see a compartmentalized way forward. That as your children, we give ourselves wholly to you. And that you sent your Son to wipe away our past so that we can step out of the guilt and the shame, that we can be in belonging with your people and your community, that you are breaking chains, you are shattering shackles to set us free into the life that we are created to have. And so I ask that you would unleash your Holy Spirit on us gathered here, that you would open our hearts, that you would open every part of our being, even the shadowiest places of our innermost being that we keep dark on purpose, that we would stop protecting those places and let you in. And we love you for the life that you have for us, and the future that we have, that you have for us. We pray this in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Amen. Let's get everyone to stand as they are able. And as we sing this last song this morning, I want you to just maybe close your eyes and think about some of those own demons that you've had inside of you at certain times in your life. And just give God the glory that he was able to bring them out of you just like he did the man. Times of question, certain circumstances, and things I could not understand. Many times in trials, weakness blurs my vision, and my frustration gets so out of hand. Then that I'm reminded, never been forsaken, never had to stand one test alone. When I look at all the victories, the Spirit rises up in me. It's through the fire my weakness is made strong. He never promised that the cross would not get heavy, and the hill would not be hard to climb. He never offered a victory without fighting, and he'd say help would always come in time. Just remember when you're standing in the valley of decision, and the adversary says, just hold on, our Lord will show up, and he will take you through the fire again. I know within myself that I would surely perish, but if I trust in the hand of God, your shield will flame again. Promise that the cross would not get heavy and the hill would not be hard to climb.
He never offered a victory without fighting, and he'd say help would always come in time. Just remember when you're standing in the valley of decision, and the adversary says give in, just hold on. Our Lord will show up, and he will take you through the fire again. Just hold on. Our Lord will show up, and he will take you through the fire again.
I'm going to do preacher's privilege here, and I'm going to add a footnote to the message, to the sermon. We talk about mental illness, and we talk about depression and anxiety and other things, addictions. They're nothing to take lightly, so I don't want you to think that I think that when we say yes to Jesus, those things magically disappear. It takes help and time, and if you ever need somebody to talk to, then your pastors are available to you, and we know how to refer. We know when a person needs to be referred to someone who specializes in what you may need. So I just want to add that. I do believe God wants us to be whole, and that the first step is to being whole in Christ. And God gives us people who can help us through that. And I do think you look more beautiful now than you did when you came in. So good job. Thank you, Jesus. go forth from this place as people who love like Jesus. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, and all God's people said, amen.